Welcome to our Wednesday evening service. I'm so glad that you're tuning in right now. And so today, another good day. We've had several people, quite a few people come, and you can't see it right now, but around the auditorium here, there's some yellow, or excuse me, orange cards out where people came today and were able to have a time of prayer specifically for our nation, for our church. And so I just appreciate those that came out, and those I know have contacted me even through texting and whatnot throughout the day and just saying, yep, I'm praying for our nation and for our church today. I couldn't make it to the church, but just wanted to let me know that they are praying, and so I appreciate that as well. So a couple quick announcements, or one very specific announcement is Kids Church. So we, as of right now, you guys know that the governor's orders were the masks are mandated for in-person services or any public buildings. So we're following those guidelines, and that didn't keep us from having Kids Church this Sunday. So this coming Sunday, in just a few days, we're going to have Kids Church again. My kids are extremely excited about coming, and so I hope others do show up as well. But there's a little bit of protocol change, so just wanted to have you bear with me for a moment. I'll explain. If you have kids and you're coming on this Sunday, I'd like you to park on the gym side parking lot there. It's nice and clean and fresh. I just did the resurfacing, so you'll have plenty of parking over there and marked out. Enter through the gym doors with the kiddos. My daughter Hannah will actually be manning a check-in station, so everybody won't be using a touch screen, and so we'll have all the check-in going through the gym. If you have a kid that's K through first grade, you're going to go into the disciples room. That's where the kids will go there. And for the second through fifth grade, they're going to go up the back set of stairs right to the Awana's room that way. And then when dismissal happens, it's not going to be a free-for-all like it was maybe 6 months ago, where kids are just coming out everywhere. I'm going to ask that the parents, and as we dismiss the regular service, ask that the parents that have kids can be dismissed maybe first, so they can go and wait and have their kids picked up. And if you're picking up a second through fifth grader, we're going to use a walkie-talkie, and they're going to let the kid know that you're ready to be. They can come down, and so kids will go up the stairs themselves, and they'll go down the stairs themselves, and just enter and exit the same way you came, so through those gym doors. Just trying to make sure that all our kids are on one side of the building, and then we've got the senior adults that are having their ABF on Fisher Hall, so to keep that traffic jam from happening, that's why we decided to do that. So I'm excited about it. I'm looking forward to it. I hope you are too. It's going to be an interesting day, I'm sure, a little bit, you know, lots of moving parts, but just bear with us, and I appreciate your patience as we work through those things. So I've got a good list of prayer requests here I'd like to read through, and then we'll go to the Lord in prayer as we start our service this evening. First on our list, and this is not exhaustive, and so if anybody's left off this list, this is just what we've received in the past week, really. So Trampas Hawkins' father, again, with pancreatic cancer. Laura Statz, as she's continuing to recover from her surgery. Edsel Prunty, renal cancer and a fractured back. My mother, the continued battle with Parkinson's and her advanced stages there and her needs. Tammy Huddleston's father, Dennis Lucas, we found out he's in a nursing home that had some COVID-19 positive cases, so the prayer for that is for him to be protected, and as well as the other residents there, that they may hopefully have not gotten that virus. Lisa Scott's mother, Faye Westfall, some complications after a surgery. And Pastor Charles' brother and his children, as they grieve the loss of their mother and his wife. And the whole Bias family there is affected by that, and so keep them in your prayers. Also, the Eidelman family, many of you know the loss of the little boy. And so it's as you can imagine, the family is really torn up, and so I pray. We need to pray for them, for their family, for strength and peace, that they'll be growing closer to God through this tragedy, and that they'll lean on him for support. And so keep them, their family, in your prayers as well. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we worship you now, and we just cry out to you, Father. And just, Father, we're weak, and we need you. Lord God, it hurts my heart to hear some of these prayer requests that just the struggles and the suffering and the pain that your people are experiencing. Lord, but we know it's not without purpose. We know that we may not know the purpose right now, Father, but we know that that you can work good out of any tragedy, and you can work good out of any hardship that we endure, that we face. Lord, help us to drive it to our help those tragedies and those circumstances to drive us to our knees in prayer to you, the only one who can provide comfort and peace to us. This world can provide a facade of comfort, but God, you are the only one who can truly be our comforter. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, Father, to be that comfort. Father, as we prepare our hearts for this message this evening from Pastor Curry, I'm excited, Father. I love going into your word, and I just pray that those that are watching right now will be moved, that your Spirit will descend upon them, and they will be moved to see an application in the scriptures that they can take and apply to their lives, that they can also share with their loved ones, with their friends and families. Lord, I pray that this message that's going out online right now, that it just reaches more and more people for your glory, Lord, for your glory, for your benefit, Father, for it benefits us through your the salvation that you provided in your Son, Jesus Christ. I pray that all those that hear this message, if they don't have that relationship, if they don't know who you are, more than just a head knowledge, if they don't have a relationship with your Son, Jesus, Father, I pray that they'll be moved by the Spirit today to ask those questions and to inquire, to reach out to a pastor, a friend, someone that can point them to the scriptures and point them to your word that provides the message of salvation, the gospel. Father, they need that. Our world needs the gospel now more than ever. Lord, help us to all be a light for you wherever we find ourselves. Help us to be bold in our faith, that we can approach someone and just ask them the question, Father, you know, if they died today, where would they spend eternity? You know, that we're eternal beings, that you made us eternal beings, and a yearning and a hole in our heart, knowing that there's something missing, Father. And I pray those that don't have that relationship with you, that they will inquire, they will seek, they will search the scriptures for that relationship. Help us, Father, as we go the rest of this week. As I said, Lord, I want to be a light for you. Please put people in my path that need you. Just people that I can minister to, and those in our congregation, Father, as well. I pray that you'll complicate our lives. You'll put somebody in our path that causes us to pause what we're doing, pause from our busy lives, so that we can focus on you. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for all that you've done for us and all you're going to do. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Good evening, Elkview family. Pastor Curry here. Thank you, Pastor Hank, for introducing the prayer needs and to mention the upcoming opening up of our children's ministry for the first time in a while. And we're thankful for all those who have worked together to make this come together. And we appreciate them so much. You can feel free to bring your children Sunday morning and know that they'll be properly cared for. They'll be treated warmly and lovely by our staff and those who are serving in these ministries. So bring the kids to church Sunday morning, 10:30 worship hour, and we're looking forward to that very much. Today, our Bible study will be in the book of Galatians, the 6th chapter, where we've been studying for a while. And last Wednesday, if you were able to tune in, you know, we talked about the power of love in dealing with helping one another with missteps in our Christian life or with burdens that we're carrying, to help one another carry those burdens and to so fulfill the law of Christ, the law of love. Well, today I want to talk about the stewardship of love. Pastor Charles, Pastor Hank, did not know where I would be coming from in this message. And so you can't blame them for anything I have to say today. I'll take full responsibility for it. But I think we'll all live through it. And for the glory of God, we can bear the subject of stewardship for sure. Well, we know that our Lord Jesus Christ, after his ascension to heaven, is there by the Father's throne, on the right hand of the Father's throne, and he makes intercession for us, and he's also preparing a place for us that he may come again and receive us unto himself in due time. And he left us here on earth, the New Testament church, God's children, he gave us charge, Great Commission as it's called, to take care of his children, to disciple one another, to share the message of salvation to the ends of the earth, and to manage his stuff until he returns. What kind of stuff? Well, it's a very wide variety of stuff, because every one of us, every one of you, have your own particular gifts and abilities that God has given you. You remember the parable of the three servants and the talents that the Lord gave. That parable the Lord Jesus gave, we'll be referring to that more in a few minutes. But I want to get your mind thinking about that, what that parable, or two parables actually together, had to do with stewardship. So we'll be looking at that. If we are to live a life of stewardship in love, we must walk in the Spirit. Remember, we shared with you that chapters 5 and 6 have to do with the sanctifying work of the Spirit through the Word in the lives of God's children. And so as we're reading this scripture, the Spirit will take the Word to your heart and mind and will help to set us apart to God, to set our mind apart, our heart, our will, so that we might be stewards in love of all that God has given us to manage for him until he comes again. So let's go right to the scriptures. Our scriptures today are verses 6 through 10. And so let's read those together. Let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived, God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, that will he also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season you shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are the household of faith, meaning God's children, of course. So first of all, we're given instructions here in verse 6 that we should share with those who teach us. We're instructed in the context of caring for one another to support those who share with us in the spiritual realm, teaching the word, preaching the word, helping us in to understand and grow in grace and knowledge. We are to share with them in our material blessings. And so in verse 6, he says, let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Now, if I may use a personal illustration, my father, as a young pastor, during the 1930s, ministered to churches in the midst of the Great Depression. Now, at that time, churches didn't have any money, and God's children didn't have any money, for the most part. And so, as a pastor, the churches would bring to my dad, now I wasn't alive to hear this, to see this, but he told me about it later, that they would bring to him such things as a sack of potatoes, or a side of bacon, or maybe produce from the garden otherwise. Things that they had that they could share with him as their pastor, and so fulfill the law of Christ's love in being a good steward of the blessings that God had given them. And many times, no doubt, they would sacrifice in order to share with the pastor some of the blessings that God had given them. So, the relationship between churches and their pastors is one of, what is the Greek word is, koinonia, which means fellowship or partnership. So, churches agree to partner with their pastor or with missionaries, with others who share the word and preach the gospel. They agree to have a fellowship of koinonia, to share the blessings that God has given. And this is a part of the stewardship that we are to do for the glory of God. In verse 7, we learn that what some people call a waste of resource. Notice what verse 7 says. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever man sows, that he will also reap. So I've heard people say, well, it's a waste of resources to pay a full-time pastor. Let that pastor work for a living and the church help with maybe some of his expenses. And then we can use that money to build bigger buildings or to take care of the poor or this, that, or the other. And pastor doesn't need to be compensated or blessed by the church in that way. So there are churches that won't pay a full-time pastor, and there are pastors who won't receive a full-time full-time care. But such thinking regards the faithful pastor materially as a waste of time, or a waste of resources. And in doing this, they are mocking God and his plan. Notice again, he says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for what a man sows, that will he reap. So if folks are not good stewards of the blessings God has given them regarding their pastor, or more than one pastor, in our case, we have two pastors, Pastor Hank, Pastor Charles, who are both full-time, and we're looking to call a youth pastor before too long, which will also be a full-time position. So we see that our church has a great responsibility to be good stewards in the manifold blessings of God in order to take care of our pastoral team. And so we thank the Lord for the church's giving. During this pandemic time, our offerings have been coming in. And there are three ways that you can give, at least three ways you can give. One, you can stop by the office, drop it off, or you can mail it into the office. You can go online to our webpage and you can give that way. Or you, of course, can bring it to the church when you come to worship on Sunday. So there are opportunities to be faithful stewards with what God has blessed in our lives. Remember, God has given us this privilege and this responsibility to manage the resources that He gives into our hands for His glory and for the good of those in need. So, Paul wrote this in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. He says in verse 11, "Since we have planted spiritual seed among you, aren't we entitled to the harvest of food and drink?" So he's asking the church, we have sown spiritual food to you. We have planted good things from the word. Now, what's wrong with us being able to participate in your blessings from the Lord? Again, in verse 14, he says, "The Lord has ordered that those who preach the good news should be supported by those who benefit from it." So there is a responsibility that we bear to share that which God has given us. Now, he says that those who sow sparingly will reap sparingly. If a person says, "No, it's not for me to tithe and to give regularly to the needs of the church. I've got other responsibilities, or I've got retirement and so on and so forth. I've got to take care of that." But remember this, there's an accounting time when God will call us to account for the way we've handled His finances, His blessings that He has poured into our own lives. So we need to be careful in how we consider these matters. In verse 8, he goes on to tell us a couple more things. He says, "For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption." Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, don't sow store up goods here just for the sake of storing up riches, because those things are going to, with the world, pass away. But he says, store up things in heaven. Now, how are we going to do that? By being good stewards, good managers of the things that God brings into our life. That includes our family, our children, our spouses. That includes our neighbors, perhaps, those in need. But it especially refers to those of the household of faith, as he says, to our pastors, to our missionaries, to the sick and the needy of the church. Some have come to the place where they believe that a church is just another welfare system for poor people and those in society. But that's not what the Lord told us. It's all right to help the poor people in society, but our first responsibility, as given in the scriptures, is to one another, is to the household of faith. So may God bless you to see that clearly today. So it's not a waste of resources to support the church and to give responsibly to the stewardship of the word and of the tithes and offerings. In verse 8, we find him saying, if we sow to the flesh, that's what we'll reap. So people might have plenty here, and they might have it stored up somewhere. And you know what? One day, they'll die and leave it all behind for someone else to spend. And so realize this, folks, and I know you do, that what God has brought into our hands to manage for Him, we ought to use it wisely to build the kingdom, to reach souls for Christ, to help God's people to grow in grace and knowledge, and to help one another to understand the wonderful blessings God has bestowed upon us. The parable of the talents I mentioned earlier tells us in Matthew chapter 25 how the Lord Jesus gave this parable to his disciples. There were three servants who were given different amounts of money to invest for their master. Two of them invested wisely, but one of them simply dug a hole in the ground, buried the money, and when his master came home, he dug it up and brought it back to him without any increase, without having used that wisely, without having been a good steward of what the master gave him. And so his master was very angry, very upset with him because he had acted lazily, foolishly, and consequently, he received no reward. And so we must recognize that what God gives us, he wants us to use wisely for the kingdom's sake and for the cause of Christ. Now, in verse 9 he says, "Let us not grow weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we do not grow tired, if we do not become weary." Don't tire of doing good, he says. In God's own time, he will bless us according with the Spirit in which we have both received and distributed his blessings. How we have managed all the blessings that he pours upon us. Now, I want to share with you real quickly two or three truths. This is the truth we need to learn early on in our stewardship for Jesus, that we can't outgive God. We need to realize that the Lord who loved us and who gave his only begotten Son for us, and he sent him into this cruel, wicked world to die on the cross to redeem us from our sins, how shall he not also with him give us all things? If he gave us his very best, how will he not give us the things we need? And so Jesus, in teaching us how to faithfully pray, he says, again, in the Sermon on the Mount, he says, "Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you." He wants us to be faithful, and he wants us to ask and seek and knock. And he wants us to continue to do this, continue to ask, continue to seek, continue to knock, and God will answer our prayers. And so he wants us to realize this, that you can't outgive God. His blessings upon your life will abundantly overshadow what you do for him. Oh, he's not going to make you rich. We're not preaching a prosperity gospel by any means. Many people have given everything and suffered much loss for the kingdom of Christ and for the service of God. They've given everything. But the truth is this, that God is able not only to bless us necessarily, but he's also able to bless us abundantly. And so we realize we cannot outgive God in our stewardship for him. Another truth is this. We should, as stewards of the Lord, hold everything that he gives us in open, outstretched hands. What do I mean by that? I mean this. We should always recognize the fact that what God has given us, he may call it back. He may require it. And so instead of us as a baby coming from the womb with clenched hands, we should not hold on to the things that God has brought to us. We should, with open hands and loving commitment to Him, be always prepared to release to Him what is His. We have nothing of our own. Everything that we have as a gift from God. Every good gift, every perfect gift comes from the Father of light, in whom there is no change. We know that He's always the same. His love for us is constant, abiding, caring, and He will always be there for us. But we must remember that we are stewards of what God gives us. We're not keepers, but we're to manage what God has given us to the best of our ability, always realizing that the Master is coming again and He will require at our hand what we have had from Him. Verse 10, in closing, we say this: we have opportunity. In verse 10, he says, therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. So, the love of stewardship, or the stewardship of love, it can be turned either way. The stewardship of love. Or the love of stewardship. Yes, we have a commission. Yes, we have a calling from God. But it should always be motivated by the deep, abiding love we have for our Heavenly Father and for one another. For the church as God's institution in the world. For God's people as His children in the world. Oh, may the Lord help us. And this is the final truth here I'll share. Don't put off to tomorrow the good you can do today. Oh, you say, I've been meaning to bring my offerings to the church, but they don't really need it. Well, as you realize, I hope you realize, that many people are suffering right now because of this pandemic and the jobs have been taken away and other problems have come up. And so many people are struggling and it's hard for them to make ends meet. And so if God has blessed you in a special way and your income has been steady and sufficient, and don't forget, God holds us accountable for what we have, not what we don't have. And so may the Lord bless us all. May He warm our hearts with the spirit of love for Him in such a way that we will want to take our stewardship for God seriously in these days, that we may be faithful in our time, in our talents, and in our tithes and offerings. So, the pastors of the church, the servants of the Lord who carry the word, they are worthy of a double honor. And so, finally, we have our instructions from the Word of God. This is what God wants from us. We have our relationship in the church family with our pastor and with the associates that help him. We have our incentives, both negative and positive. The negative incentive was, you'll get what you sow. You'll reap accordingly. If you sow to the flesh, that's what you're going to get. But if you sow to the Spirit, then you're going to get spiritual blessings. And then we have the incentive positively that we shall reap a harvest in due time, in God's time. As opportunity presents itself, this word opportunity simply says, as the time permits, or as the opportunity is presented, Don't put it off. God bless you. Be faithful. And we hope to see you in church this Sunday. God bless you. Have a good evening. Thank you for listening.